listening to BostonFreeRadio.com.
Hello and welcome to the... Welcome to the show, Words on Film, the show to which you are listening on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. You are either listening to me on BostonFreeRadio.com, watching me on SCAT-V, or watching and listening to me on Facebook Live. Either way, you're watching or consuming this media, I'm glad to have you with me. So I've got five new movies to review for you for this week, but first let's get into my segment, What's Topping the Box Office, the top 10 highest grossing films of this past weekend. The first is actually the number one highest grossing debut movie, which actually isn't a surprise to me that this is number one. If the movie that's number two was number one, I'd be really surprised, but I expected this. The Lego Batman movie debuts at number one at the box office, having earned $53 million in the U.S. alone. That's against a budget of $80 million, and so far its international gross is $90.2 million. Making the Lego Batman movie not a hit yet here in the States, but internationally it's already a tentative hit, and that's pretty good. 50 Shades Darker is the number two highest grossing debut movie of the week, and it's also number two at the box office. Those two are not necessarily the same things. 50 Shades Darker earned $46.6 million this past weekend, despite... the first movie not being everybody's cup of tea, but I guess it knows what its demographic is. So just to give you a little bit of perspective, 50 Shades of Grey from 2 years ago had a budget of $40 million and ended up grossing $571 million worldwide. Kind of a shame. 50 Shades Darker has actually a higher budget of $55 million, but it grossed actually $144.6 million worldwide. So while 50 Shades Darker is not a hit yet here in the States, internationally it is already a certified hit, which boggles my mind. Another sequel, John Wick Chapter 2, is the third highest grossing debut movie of the week and is number three at the box office, having earned $30.4 million this past weekend in the United States. Against a budget of $40 million, John Wick Chapter 2 has also earned $41.9 million around the world, making it a tentative hit here in the States and off to a pretty good start considering its competition, and a tentative hit around the world. So far, John Wick, well, actually the whole series of John Wick movies, is an underdog that seems to have done well for itself so far. Split was number one at the box office last week. This week, it is number four at the box office, and its fourth week in release. It's its very first time being knocked off from the number one spot ever since its debut. But it's still doing well for itself. This weekend, it grossed $9.5 million. Against a budget of $10 million, Split has so far grossed, in the United States alone, $112.5 million, and around the world it has grossed $169.4 million, which naturally makes it a certified hit with a bullet here in the States and around the world. Hidden Figures is another movie that's doing really well, although it slid a little bit. Last week it was number four at the box office. This weekend it's number five, having earned this weekend in the United States an even $8 million. Against a budget of $25 million, though, Hidden Figures has so far earned $131.5 million here in the States and $140.2 million around the world. So it's earned a bulk of its money in the United States, because remember, when I calculate it's around the world, that's including in the United States. So in every other country besides the United States, Hidden Figures has only earned less than $9 million. However, it is still a certified hit here in the States and around the world. A Dog's Purpose is number 6 at the box office this weekend, sliding from number 3 last week in its third week in release. But A Dog's Purpose is finding enough of an audience to have grossed $7.3 million in the United States thus far. This weekend. Against a budget of $22 million, A Dog's Purpose has earned $42.5 million here in the States and $56.4 million around the world. So A Dog's Purpose is a tentative hit here in the States. It only has a couple more million to go to become a certified hit, but it's very close to being a certified hit. But around the world, it's already certified. Rings is number 7 at the box office weekend, actually making the biggest drop from number 2 last week. And this is in its second week in release. Rings, which as you might remember is a sequel to The Ring, has earned $5.6 million this weekend. Against a budget of $25 million, Rings has so far earned $21.3 million here in the States and $51.9 million around the world, which means it's not a hit yet here in the States, but around the world, it's already a certified hit. So good for that movie. La La Land slid a little bit. It was actually number 5 at the box office last week. This week, it's number 8. And it earned $4.9 million at the box office in the United States this past weekend. But against a budget of $30 million, La La Land has so far earned $126 million here in the United States and a staggering $294.3 million around the world. So La La Land isn't making the same kind of money that Rogue One did a couple of weeks ago, but it's still a certified hit here in the States and around the world. Lion is number 9 at the box office this weekend, actually climbing a little bit from number 10 last week. And Lion, which you might remember, stars Dev Patel, Rooney Mara, and Nicole Kidman, and has been nominated for several Academy Awards, is actually still doing better. It earned $4 million at the box office in the United States this weekend. Against a budget of $12 million, a relatively modest budget, it has so far in the United States earned $30.2 million, that's just in the United States, and around the world it has earned $44.5 million, making it already a certified hit here in the States and around the world. And finally, number 10 of the box office, the movie Sing, has been creeping down steadily, but it's been in the box office for 8 weeks, so you have to expect a movie like that that's been out for as long as it has to have slid. But this weekend it earned $1.7 million. Against a budget of $75 million, Sing has earned $265.4 million here in the States and $502 million around the world, which makes it a certified hit here in the States and around the world. However, it has made actually half of what Zootopia and Finding Dory have made individually, but you can't fault it that much. It has made a profit, especially on a lesser budget than those two movies. Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are listening on bostonfreeradio.com or watching me on SCATV or Facebook Live. Either way, I'm glad you could join me for the show. The first movie I'm going to review for you is the Lego Batman movie, which is kind of a sequel to the Lego movie from 2014, but not really. The Lego Batman movie is more of a spin-off. It sort of acknowledges the events of the Lego movie, which featured Batman as well as several other superheroes. But it's, even though it takes place after, it takes place in another universe. In other words, the universe of Gotham City in its Lego glory. So in the Lego Batman movie, of course, the focus is on the Caped Crusader himself, who is voiced by Will Arnett, who did the voice for Batman in the Lego movie from 3 years ago. So Batman slash Bruce Wayne must not only deal with the several criminals of Gotham City, I think there's no criminal, there's no Batman villain in this movie that's left behind. The primary one is the Joker, but several other Batman villains from years and maybe even decades past make appearances in this movie as well. So not only does Bruce Wayne have to combat the criminals of Gotham City, but he also has to deal with the responsibility of raising a boy he adopted named Dick Grayson, who we all know as Robin, and who eventually creates his superhero alter ego. And Robin slash Dick Grayson in this movie is voiced by Michael Cera, who has been a household name for the last 10 years, but actually hasn't been in a lot of movies. But either way, I didn't actually recognize Michael Cera as the voice of Robin. He almost kind of creates sort of a comedic, childlike persona for this movie. And I mean, to Michael Cera's credit, it's great that I actually couldn't tell it was him, but anyway, so there is a lot going on in this movie, and it almost seems a little bit like villain overload. You do have the Joker, who, as you might expect, is the primary villain, but you also have Harley Quinn, the Penguin, Catwoman, Bane, Poison Ivy, Mr. Freeze. All of them make cameo appearances here, and it almost, it's great that the Joker could be the main villain of this movie. And the Joker, by the way, is voiced brilliantly by Zach Galifianakis, another voice actor I couldn't exactly, I couldn't quite tell it was him who was voicing the Joker. I guess I might have guessed David Cross or Patton Oswalt, because of course Zach Galifianakis is not known for his distinctive voice. Not, I don't mean to say that he has a bad voice or anything like that. It's just not quite as distinctive as the comic actors I mentioned, David Cross and Patton Oswalt. But of course he's known more for his trademark beard than anything. But when he's actually doing a voice in a movie, whether it's Joker in this movie or whether it's Humpty Dumpty in the Puss in Boots movie from years ago, I think that might have been 7 years ago now, he still provides a good, competent voice for the character. So the Lego Batman movie is not only a parody of Legos in general, as well as a tribute, but it's also a parody of all the incarnations of Batman over the last couple of years, or last couple of decades, I should say. Everything from the original TV show, and I can't believe I'm blanking on, with Adam West, forget I blanked on that name, to the Tim Burton, Joel Schumacher, and Christopher Nolan movies. Not to mention the recent Zack Snyder movie, which starred Ben Affleck as Batman. All of those are lampooned in one way or another here, and cleverly. In other words, there are times where specific scenes from each movie is lampooned, but there are times where, if this makes sense, a lot of moments are actually, shall we say, acknowledged and, I think, captured in a creative way in this movie. So Will Arnett plays Batman almost kind of like Will Ferrell plays Anchorman. In other words, as a character who's very good at what he does, but is overly cocky to the point where you can't take him seriously, nor should you. In fact, the fact that this is the Lego Batman movie shows that the people who made this movie probably had a blast doing it, even though it probably wasn't easy to animate. And even more so, it's almost tapping into when you're a kid and you're playing with your various toys, and or especially with Lego toys. It kind of taps into sort of that childhood imagination with playing with such toys, especially when certain other villains from other franchises, not just comic book movies, make a certain cameo in this movie. And to tell you exactly how they make a cameo in this movie and how they tie into the Batman universe would actually ruin the film. But there is one point where Batman takes this gun that is... the certain transporter, which he shoots Joker with, and rather than being a regular gun, it's a transporter that transports Joker to another dimension. And I thought this other dimension would be the same dimension used in the original Lego movie, but it turns out, somewhat disappointingly, but fortunately to the movie maker's credit, it wasn't predictable. It transports him to another dimension where there are other villains. And I just thought when Joker took over and brought these villains back to the Gotham City universe, it fortunately didn't make the movie boring and made it exciting to watch. In fact, I can't think of any dull moments in this movie. I think probably the dullest moment was where Batman takes Robin, and if you'll excuse the pun, under his wing. I guess there's really no other way to say it. That part was kind of draggy, and I guess I sort of predicted the whole Batman wanting to be a drifter and working alone. I sort of expected that, but it didn't take away from the great special effects in this movie, not to mention a movie that's probably going to please every comic book aficionado, as well as anyone who's played with Legos as a kid, which is why I give this movie my rating of a knockout. I think it's the best animated movie of the year so far, and it even rivals some animated movies that came out last year. Welcome back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, and I'm glad you could join me. The next movie I'm going to be reviewing for you is 50 Shades Darker. Did I look forward to seeing this movie? Absolutely not. As you might remember from 2 years ago, I declared 50 Shades of Grey the worst movie of 2015. And, well, 50 Shades Darker, because of that reason, is a movie I was not looking forward to seeing. And apparently, the director of the original 50 Shades of Grey, Sam Taylor Johnson, wasn't looking forward to directing it either, which is why 50 Shades Darker here was directed by James Foley. And James Foley might not be a familiar name to you, but he's directed a wide array of movies. The last movie he directed was actually from 2007. It was called Perfect Stranger, and it starred Halle Berry and Bruce Willis. But his best movie, James Foley's best movie so far, has been Glengarry Glen Ross, which starred Al Pacino, Jack Lemmon, Alec Baldwin, and a number of other notable actors. So you wouldn't have guessed that someone who had directed Glengarry Glen Ross would go on to direct 50 Shades Darker, but here you go. I think it was Entertainment Weekly that said last year that 50 Shades Darker was, and I quote, the biggest game of not it amongst Hollywood directors. Well, somebody had to direct it, especially considering that the original 50 Shades of Grey, on a budget of $40 million, grossed worldwide $571 million. So yeah, critics, including myself, hated it, but, well, what can I tell you? It's back. So what has changed from 50 Shades Darker? Well, this time, Anastasia Steele is not a college student. She is actually working in a publishing company as an administrative assistant, and she has more or less cut ties with Christian Grey. So Christian Grey gets in contact with her again, and while Christian wrestles with his inner demons, Anastasia must confront the anger and envy of the women who came before her. So the plot is not just Anastasia and Christian getting together and having kinky, controversial sex involving bondage, although there is that. But this movie has you believe that there is something resembling a plot. So, is 50 Shades Darker better than 50 Shades of Grey? I have to say, reluctantly, yes it is. However, Jamie Dornan still sucks as Christian Grey. He's probably the most miscast person in the last movie. He doesn't even look like he's trying to act. I will grant him that he shows a little bit more charisma in this movie than he did in the previous movie, but it's still not good enough. His acting is pretty bad. Dakota Johnson is an actress who may have suffered a little bit from the stigma of the original 50 Shades of Grey, but I've seen her in a lot of other movies, including How to Be Single and another actually impressive movie she did last year with Ralph Fiennes and Tilda Swinton called A Bigger Splash, which was a movie where not only was she good in it, but she was also really sexy in that movie. So here, I guess it's required that she have sex, of course, she and Christian Grey. And, of course, that's the selling point of this movie. And I do give 50 Shades Darker more credit than 50 Shades of Grey in that the sex in this movie is actually sexier. They do show actually a lot more skin, if you will. I guess there's no way around it. But all the other plot elements of this movie are brought to a boil so much that they almost peter out. Like, for instance, there's one scene where Anastasia is actually confronted and nearly sexually assaulted by her boss, and I thought that was an intense scene up until it ended, and the way Christian Grey himself dealt with that situation could have been done a lot better. There's also a jealous ex-girlfriend, or shall we say, what's the right word for it? A previous liaison of Christian Grey who comes to confront Anastasia with a gun. And as good an actress as Dakota Johnson is, there's a moment where the gun is pointed at her and this previous liaison of Christian Grey actually fires the gun in Anastasia's direction and doesn't hit her. And the reaction of Dakota Johnson as Anastasia Steele is so poorly underplayed, which leads me to believe that, yes, there's going to be another 50 Shades movie coming out later. I think it's called 50 Shades Revealed. It's a movie that I will see. I'm not going to look forward to seeing it. And there were moments in 50 Shades Darker that actually bored me and put me to sleep. Basically, any scene where Anastasia and Christian were not having sex was, or where there wasn't gunplay involved, literal gunplay, was just boring to me. And I guess that's a step up from 50 Shades of Grey overall being underwhelming and overall, that movie was just boring, not to mention it was poorly acted. So 50 Shades Darker was a little bit better. I very reluctantly acknowledge that. I mean, the only reason they made 50 Shades Darker was because the original one made so much money based on the reason why people would go see it and the fact that the books were sleeper hits. In other words, they were books that came out in stores. They sold really well despite having little advertising, at least in terms of publishing companies coming out and saying, buy this book. But I can't recommend 50 Shades Darker. I guess people will go to this movie to get turned on, but I think people would be more turned on by a Google search than by 50 Shades Darker. But, of course, I'm not the target audience for this movie. But I do acknowledge that it is better and it is sexier than the original 50 Shades of Grey. But Jamie Dornan's acting is still terrible. Dakota Johnson can and has done so much better in other movies she's done since 50 Shades of Grey. But it's slightly better, so I give it my rating of a strikeout. I am still not recommending this movie, but it has fewer flaws than 50 Shades of Grey, and I commend James Foley for accomplishing that as a director. Back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. Thanks for joining me. The next movie I'm going to review for you is John Wick, Chapter 2, the sequel to the John Wick movie of 2014, which was a surprise hit. It wasn't expected to break any box office records, but the original John Wick, on just a budget of $20 million, made $86 million worldwide, which was far better than expected, especially given when John Wick was released in theaters, which was in October, which is kind of in between the summer and the winter, obviously. But what I mean by that is it's between the summer movie season and the Christmas movie season, or the holiday movie season. So people weren't expecting a lot out of John Wick, but it did well given its lack of hype. Well, it was enough to merit a sequel, which actually had a budget of $40 million, so twice that much of the original, and it shows that Keanu Reeves is still a box office draw, and he looks really good considering that he is 51 years old. It's incredible. He's 51 years old, and yet in this movie, I guess in life, he looks no older than 35. That's unbelievable to me. I'm just wondering what he's going to look like when he's 60, but I'll worry about that later. So John Wick is back, and after returning to the criminal underworld, reluctantly, to repay a debt, John Wick discovers that a large bounty has put on his life. And as established by the original John Wick movie, John Wick is not a guy you would want to mess with. If you steal his car or kill his dog, He won't brush it off. He will come right after you. And in fact, in the very beginning of this movie, he comes after basically a whole gang of Russian mobsters just because they took his car. And he goes as far as not only killing all these mobsters, but also taking back his basically totaled car, just going through the trouble of doing that, even though his car is completely totaled. Well, this time, he's not seeking revenge on the mobsters who killed his dog and stole his car. Instead, he is returning to the criminal underworld in order to kill somebody's sister. In fact, the man whose sister he has to kill is Santino D'Antonio, who's played in this movie by Ricardo Scamarcio. I hope I pronounced that name right. So, a number of people come back to reprise their roles. Ian McShane is back as Winston, who's kind of like the agent, sort of the Agent Q to John Wick, except he doesn't really invent things. He's sort of a liaison between John Wick and the criminal underworld. Also returning is Lance Reddick as Charon, who is a seemingly unassuming hotel front desk clerk, but as you learn, He has more connections to the criminal underworld than meets the eye. And, of course, John Leguizamo makes a brief appearance in the in this movie as criminal underworld mechanic Aurelio. I hope I pronounced that character's name right, but what can I tell you? So, at first, I was a little bit bored by the first 30 minutes of the movie. I kind of thought to myself, okay, John Wick's going to kill this sister, and then what? Well, first of all, the scene in which the sister dies, and that's not really a spoiler, she does die, I'm not going to tell you how, is pretty intense. And it's actually, it's disturbing and poetic at the same time. I thought actually the effects of watching her die were effectively haunting. And I think that was probably the image that stood out to me the most of this movie. And I think it's when this woman dies that the movie gets really, really good and arguably better and maybe even more memorable than the original, which I didn't think that was possible. But now that the original John Wick has passed by and it's been 3 years since it's been released, I remember some things about it. I remember the dog getting killed. I remember a lot of the characters, especially those played by John Leguizamo and Ian McShane. But I don't really remember much else. This movie actually gives you a lot to remember because once this sister dies, and I'm not going to say whether John Wick kills her or not, but she does die, that's when the movie gets really interesting because this character, Santino De Antonio, puts out a bounty on John Wick. Much to the, well, let me just say this, against the advice of Winston, Ian McShane's character, because just like any hero of most crime dramas, you don't want to mess with the main character. In fact, John Wick is almost kind of like Shaft, with a shorter temper, with lighter skin, and also more karate moves. Well, I won't say karate or kung fu, but basically better moves than Shaft. In other words, he's a guy you don't want to mess with, and for good reason. John Wick 2 is the furthest, or John Wick Chapter 2 is the furthest thing from realism that you can get. In fact, John Wick takes a beating in this movie. He survives car crashes, he survives stabbings, shootings, but still, I thought the main component of this movie was how fun it became and how intriguing it became after John Wick does what he's told to do, only to realize he's been set up. And I thought there were some other very memorable supporting roles by Common, who plays a fellow bounty hunter named Cassian, and also Lawrence Fishburne, who is the unassuming or seemingly unassuming leader of another underground movement named Bowery King. But that's the name of his character, not the movement. So John Wick Chapter 2 was a better movie than I thought it would be, and I think inevitably they're going to make a third movie, but I give it my rating actually of a knockout. I think that Keanu Reeves plays a great leading man. It's the first time he's actually really played a tough guy. Granted, he's played action heroes before in movies like Point Break and, of course, the Matrix trilogy, but this is the one where he takes a real beating, something that maybe even Neo from the Matrix couldn't even handle, and he makes you not care about the beating he takes being unrealistic or contrived. There's just a lot to like about John Wick Chapter 2. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are listening on bostonfreeradio.com or watching and listening on SCAT-V and on Facebook Live. I'm glad you could join me either way. The next movie I'm going to be reviewing for you is a movie called The Space Between Us. This is a young adult movie mixed with science fiction, and it's the movie about the first human born on Mars, who travels to Earth for the first time, experiencing the wonder of the planet through fresh eyes. He embarks on an adventure to find his father with a street-smart girl to discover how he came to be. So here's the setup to the movie. So, this is in the not-too-distant future, specifically the year 2030, where a team of astronauts, four men and one woman, go to Mars in order to colonize the planet. And, well, there's a lot of techniques as to how they colonize the planet, but mainly they create a literal bubble in which they can reside and survive on Mars amidst the harsh realities of the deserted planet itself. So the woman on the mission turns out to be pregnant, and she finds that out on her way to Mars. So she actually gives birth to a son on Mars, who's the first human born on Mars in this universe, and she dies giving birth to him. What's a mystery is who the father of this boy actually is. But the boy grows up in this sort of inner space colonization on Mars, and he grows up to be He grows up to be a boy named Gardner Elliott, who's a 16-year-old who in this movie is played by Asa Butterfield. And Asa Butterfield is an actor who you might remember from movies like Hugo, where he played the title character, and Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children from last year. He's also been in a number of other movies, but Hugo and Miss Peregrine's You Know the Rest are the most notable movies in which he starred. So he's raised pretty well, especially by a mother surrogate named Kendra Windham, who in this movie is played by Carla Gugino. And Gardner has never actually met anyone face-to-face who is his age. Granted, he's a very smart kid, he's a whiz at computers, but his only human friend who is his age is actually a girl who lives on Earth in a small town. And she communicates with him via Instant Messenger, or I guess Facebook Messenger, one of those social media, one of those internet ways of communication. I sound so old when I say that, but remember, I'm giving you my synopsis off the top of my head. Well, that character's name is Tulsa, something about strange names in this movie, and she's played by Britt Robertson. So eventually, Gardner takes a trip to Earth from Mars, and normally a trip like this would take 16 months, but in this movie, I guess the technology is advanced enough so that somebody could get from Earth to Mars in a shorter amount of time. Granted, it would still take a few months, but it wouldn't take nearly as long as it probably would in real life. So Gardner is seeing the world for the first time and realizes that he doesn't have to put on a helmet or a spacesuit in order to experience the outside when he's on Earth. But he also finds that the gravity works differently on Earth than it does on Mars. And there are some pretty funny moments in this movie where you see him on Mars going about his life as he does, and then when he gets to Earth, the scientific reasons he doesn't fit in on Earth are actually kind of fun to watch in this movie. I do have to say that once he and Britt Robertson get together, the movie kind of almost teeters on the sort of Twilight teen fiction melodrama, but fortunately doesn't go as far as Twilight. In fact, the mystery of who Gardner's father really is somewhat predictable, even though they try to throw in a twist. But as much as this movie resembles some teen lit that's been coming out over the last couple of years. It is actually an original story written by Alan Loeb, Richard Barton Lewis, and Stuart Schill, which was made into a screenplay by Alan Loeb. So this movie hasn't been advertised very well and might be considered a commercial flop based on the fact that it was number 9 at the box office last week and this week wasn't in the top 10. And last week it only grossed $3.5 million on a budget of $30 million. But I think it's good as a science fiction movie. It falls somewhat flat as a teen melodrama movie. In fact, I think it embraces melodrama a little bit more than I think it should have. And it's really unfortunate to see a good actress like Britt Robertson, not to mention a good actor like Asa Butterfield, get caught up or maybe even typecast in these movies of romantic melodrama. Like, for instance, Britt Robertson was in a movie based on a Nicholas Patterson novel called The Longest Ride, which co-stars Scott Eastwood. And I think since then, she's been in at least three other movies where she plays someone who, yes, is street smart and certainly isn't a damsel in distress, for which I give the people who cast Britt Robertson full credit. But she's also, I think the problem is, she's typecast in these movies, and I would like to see Britt Robertson do something different. In fact, I've had the same problem with Greta Gerwig in a lot of her movies, with some exceptions. She always plays the same kind of millennial who's very book smart, but when it comes to street smarts, she doesn't quite know what to do. And I think it's good that she's played that in one movie, but she's played it in several movies. But I like The Space Between Us for its science fiction component. I thought the idea of a human being born on Mars was actually pretty fascinating. And in fact, a more appropriate title for The Space Between Us could have been The Martian. Lo and behold, that title was taken. But I do think The Space Between Us is good for streaming, and I give it my rating of a checkout. I do think the actors in the movie were good and gave it what they could, but the melodrama component really wasn't needed all that much. Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, and you're probably listening to me on bostonfreeradio.com or watching and listening to me on SCAT-V or listening and watching to me, watching me on Facebook Live. In either instance, thank you for joining me. The next movie I'm going to be reviewing for you is 20th Century Women. This is a movie that came out a while ago. Its release date was January 20th, and it was released early enough for it to be eligible for Oscar nominations and actually Golden Globe nominations. So far, well, actually, I shouldn't say so far, because the Academy Award nominations are what they are, and there's no changing them. It's been nominated for one Academy Award for Best Writing Original Screenplay, Mike Mills, who not only wrote the screenplay but also directed the movie. And it has been nominated actually for two completely different Golden Globes. It was nominated for Best Motion Picture, Musical or Comedy, which I don't think quite fits it because there were some funny moments, but overall this is a drama movie, and Best Performance by an Actress in a Motion Picture, Musical or Comedy, Annette Bening. So 20th Century Women notice it's 20th century women and not 21st century women, is a movie that takes place in 1979, hence one of the years of the 20th century. And it's the story of three women and one adolescent boy who explore love and freedom in Southern California during the late 1970s. I think this movie takes place in San Diego. It doesn't take place in San Francisco, that I know. It might take place in L.A., I don't quite remember. But the three women in this movie include Dorothea, who was a woman who was born right before the Great Depression, played by Annette Bening. You also have adolescent Julie, played by Elle Fanning. And you have a woman in her 20s, Abby, played by Greta Gerwig, the latter of whom actually has to deal with having cervical cancer. And they all live together in one house. Actually, Elle Fanning's character, Julie, doesn't live there, but she frequents there often, especially to visit a boy who has a crush on her, but the crush is somewhat unrequited. That boy is Jamie, and he's played by young actor Lucas Jade Zuman. And this movie seems like it would be biographical, but from what from my research, I don't think it is. I don't think it's based on Mike Mills' life, or at least it hasn't been acknowledged that it is in any print evidence or even video evidence that I've seen, but it's still an original movie about original people. And also living together in this house of two women and one young boy is a carpenter named William, who's played by Billy Crudup, who I thought was actually one of the more miscast members of this movie. So the movie is more of a slice of life movie for me, which is, well, not for me, but for anybody who watches it. And what I mean by slice of life movie is it's not a movie that has a particular plot. In fact, it does delve into a little nostalgia taking place in the late 70s, and especially with the young boy in this movie, whose name is Jamie. I have to keep reminding myself that. His interest in punk rock and not disco. In fact, you don't hear a single disco song in this movie, which is probably good for people who hate disco. But anyway, it's the single mother, played by Annette Bening, Dorothea, who was born in the 20s and had a child late in her life when she was in her 40s. Now she's in her mid-50s and is trying to really understand her son. And there are scenes in this movie where she actually listens and tries to understand punk rock music. And very much like my parents, she doesn't. Granted, my parents weren't born in the 20s. If I even implied that, both of them would be very upset with me. But, you know, there's the whole deal about there being a generation gap. And in terms of the storytelling structure of this movie, it's more or less straightforward, but there are moments where actually each character has their turn in narrating the film, and they also almost jump forward in time to tell the audience that 20 years from when this moment takes place, I will die of something, or I will be married to this person. I don't want to give too much away, but Annette Bening's I'm gonna stop right there. But basically, every character in this movie has a story. Every character in this movie has a future of which they are aware, almost clairvoyantly. But anyway, I thought Annette Bening was good in this movie. I don't think it was her strongest performance, and she was not nominated for an Oscar for this movie, but I do think it was for a relatively good reason, because I don't think it was her standout performance. It certainly wasn't as strong as her supporting performances, or maybe even leading performances, in movies like The Kids Are All Right or American Beauty. And American Beauty is a movie that's experienced a little bit of backlash in recent years, even though it received critical acclaim back when it came out. But rest assured, the actors in the movie, especially Kevin Spacey and Annette Bening, were fantastic in that movie. They did really well with their roles And I don't think that can be disputed. And I don't think the acting performance is in this movie can be disputed either. I think it's good to see Greta Gerwig play somebody other than a somewhat jaded early millennial. Granted, she is somewhat... She plays a woman in her 20s who doesn't quite know what to do with her life, which is familiar territory with her, especially after movies like Mistress America and Frances Ha and other movies she's done with Noah Baumbach. But she brings a different flavor to it here, and I give her credit for that. But as I said, Billy Crudup in this movie looks almost exactly like he did in Almost Famous, but he plays a guy who might be borderline autistic in the sense that he knows a lot about carpentry, and he tries to be the male influence in Jamie's life with Dorothea's encouragement, but that doesn't work out because, according to Jamie, everything he says is boring. And I guess it could be, but there's a lot to take into 20th Century Women. I give it my rating of a checkout. I don't think it's a movie that people will be talking about even a year from now, but as a somewhat nostalgic slice of life movie, it does what it needs to do.
Okay, what are you wearing right now?
Nothing.
That's right. So mommy's going to teach you how to dress yourself. Underwear always comes first, name tag.
Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, and I'm glad you could join me on this show. This is actually my last segment. I've done all the movies I'm going to review. Now I'm going to give you my segment of What's Coming Out Next, a segment that is exactly what you think it would be, which is the movies that are coming out next weekend and that I will probably see, or I may not, depending on whether or not they are in limited release or not. But either way, we have three actually big movies coming out this weekend. I don't think any of them will knock out the Lego Batman movie from the number one spot, but then again, I could be wrong. The first movie of note is The Great Wall. This is a movie that's generated a lot of controversy, especially considering that Matt Damon is in the starring role and not an Asian or even Asian American actor. This is something that a number of critics, including actress Constance Wu, has cited of Hollywood whitewashing their movies, who should have minority or even foreign characters in them. So it's a valid criticism, but the movie itself I'm going to see, and I'll let you know what I think. I don't have high hopes for this movie based on its controversy, which I do think is valid, but here's the plot of The Great Wall. European mercenaries searching for black powder become embroiled in the defense of the Great Wall of China against a horde of monstrous creatures. So, this movie is labeled as action, adventure, fantasy, thriller. It's not, I don't think, based on a true story, especially since, now remember, I have not seen any of the previews for The Great Wall because I don't watch previews anymore, but a horde of monstrous creatures... It would be one thing if it were Mongolians trying to attack the Great Wall, which would be based on a true story, but putting creatures in them, in this kind of movie, I don't know. It sounds kind of stupid to me, but maybe this movie will exceed my expectations. We'll have to see. But the movie stars Matt Damon, Qian Jing, Willem Dafoe, and Andy Lau, amongst others. It sounds like a lot of genres mashed into one, but I'll see it and I'll let you know what I think next week. Another movie that's coming out, which I definitely will see, is a movie called Fist Fight. This movie stars Ice Cube, Charlie Day, and Tracy Morgan, amongst other actors, who are coming into this comedy, and it's about teachers at a public school who, when one teacher gets the other fired, he is challenged to an after-school fight. So this is kind of like that 80s movie 3 o'clock High, except instead of students getting into a big fight, it's teachers. It sounds original, and Ice Cube is usually good as the straight man in comedies, and of course, Tracy Morgan is coming back to the big screen for the first time since that truck accident that almost cost Tracy Morgan his life. It's good to see him back on the big screen again, and of course, Charlie Day is usually pretty fun. I mean, he's absolutely hilarious in It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and he was pretty funny in the first Horrible Bosses. The second Horrible Bosses, not so much, but it wasn't his fault that movie was subpar. But I'll let you know what I think about Fist Fight when I see it in theaters for next week's show. And the other movie that's coming out, in wide release is a movie called A Cure for Wellness. This is directed by Gore Verbinski, who's brought us several of the Pirates of the Caribbean movies. And this movie is very, very different from the family-friendly Pirates of the Caribbean. It's a movie that's a mystery and a thriller, and it's rated R. It's a movie about an ambitious young executive who is sent to retrieve his company's CEO from an idyllic but mysterious quote-unquote wellness center at a remote location in the Swiss Alps, but soon suspects that the spa's miraculous treatments are not what they seem. So the poster for this movie seems really spooky. And the movie stars Dane DeHaan, who you might remember from such movies as Chronicle and The Amazing Spider-Man 2, the latter of which he played the Green Goblin. I know his last name was Osborn. I forgot his first name, forgive me. But the movie also co-stars, A Cure for Wellness co-stars Jason Isaacs, Mia Goth, and Ivo Nandi.